talk like this as part of the compassion symposium. So yeah, you know, just to have someone speak on behalf of non-human animals as part of a symposium of compassion, it makes perfect sense to me, but it's not something that we could have taken for granted even a few years ago. So that's brilliant, thank you, and thanks for all coming along to this sub-session. As James already said, I'm Catherine from Animal Liberation Queensland. I think it might have had me down as director, which is a little bit misleading because we're a committee of 6 and we're all directors, you know, board members. We're a 100% volunteer-run organisation. So it's the committee is kind of the driving force, but then we have vast numbers of volunteers as well who do amazing things for us. We're also a registered charity. Sorry, I should be introducing ALQ at this point. So yeah, our aim is to protect all animals from abuse and exploitation. We work to be a voice for animals, running campaigns, outreach, and advocacy to inspire change for a more compassionate world. And this is just our mission statement. You can have a quick skim through that. And our main campaign area, many people may know about, they may remember from a few years ago, the Four Corners expose of live baiting in the greyhound racing industry. That was based on investigative work by ALQ and Animals Australia. But as well as that, which was, I guess, quite a high profile campaign, and that continues, we do quite a lot on rodeos, so we campaign against the cruelty of rodeos, which unfortunately Queensland holds the title of rodeo state, so it's like a big issue for us. And we have also a puppy farm campaign, so campaigning for legislative change and also, you know, just promoting the message of adopt, don't shop. We have a bunch of other sort of less, I guess, prominent campaign areas, so things like campaign for protesting against the use of live animals in circuses and other issues as they arise. But veganism, as I said at the beginning, is my focus, and that's for a few reasons which I might touch on as we go. But as to why I sort of landed up doing that, I've been involved in vegan campaigning now for about, I guess, 7 years, including back in London where I used to live, where I'm from, with a group called London Vegan Campaign. So I'll continue with that here. So I suppose I want to just give the definition to start with. I mean, most people know what vegan means these days, but it's just useful to go back to looking, you know, at the original definition, which still stands. It's about excluding living a lifestyle that enables us to avoid causing harm to animals as far as we possibly can through our daily choices. But having said that we promote veganism, I just want to make it clear that ALQ's approach is all about meeting people where they are and helping them take the next step, whatever it may be. So we're not like, oh, you have to be vegan. We understand that there are many sort of barriers and challenges to that. We just welcome people who are willing to start investigating it, and you know, it's not a club or anything like that. So I just want to make that clear. It's really all about values and goals, and we believe that these are shared values and goals, really, that we have as just in our common humanity. So we do things what's at the crux of this is basically treading lightly and valuing compassion and justice. So this is kind of also where, so my background was more in sort of environmental campaigning initially, and really over time I realized that campaigning for veganism can achieve that at the same time as having sort of tangible change, because every time somebody makes a choice that means they're not consuming animals in their products, I'm actually really making a difference that I can see, you know, whereas and at the same time it's achieving other goals that I have. So it's a stand against oppression, and I'm heartened also every day by how this movement is growing and how more people are coming in and asking questions, getting curious, and being part of the change. But it's not all good news. I mean, unfortunately, the numbers suffering in the food system are larger than ever. because of sheer numbers of humans and also increasing prosperity, I guess, and the value that we place on meat still. So it's just really hard to wrap our heads around the numbers sometimes. So we say 65 billion land animals are killed each year in the, for food. And, you know, it kind of helps to see all those zeros just to sort of start adding up that this is one plus one plus one plus one plus one, you know. And every single one of them was somebody with a life and with interests of their own. Globally, it can help to sort of break it down if you think, okay, that's 1.2 billion every week, which is more than all humans killed in all wars in all of history. That's every week. And it's trillions more if you include the aquatic animals. Australia kills almost 700 million every year, and we've got the per person numbers there as well. I actually got Cameron to do the maths, and apparently it works out as approximately 22 per second slaughtered in Australia, just in Australia alone, every second. So that's now and now and now and now, you know, every second. It is hard to get your head around. So I don't really want to traumatize you guys with a lot of detailed facts and painful imagery or anything like that. I think most of us are quite aware, to some extent anyway, of what goes on in these industries. It's not Old MacDonald's farm. I think we all kind of know that, although there are many things that stop us from maybe facing that as much as, we've kind of taught not to ask those questions and not to talk about it too much. And that's partly why we get vilified a little bit as vegans for talking about it too much. You know, it comes up that you're vegan, and then we get the old jokes like, how do you know there's a vegan in the room? Don't worry, they'll tell you, you know. And
where do you get your protein?
Yeah, I mean, actually, on that note, I just said to James, I want to finish hopefully 10 minutes early so we can have some Q&A. Like, I'm not sure what mix we have in the audience and what kinds of questions, but that's just, yeah. So if I'm rambling, I will try not to, so we still have time for those Q&A bits at the end. But really, what I suppose I want to say here is just a general picture. So just to dwell on the lives, you know, how they live and how they die. Because sadly, it is a story of great violence, and it's an area where, as I said, our natural inclinations of compassion are stifled from an early age. The reality is these are animals who are emotionally complex, intelligent beings with a potential for rich experiences of the world. But most will never see the sun, feel the earth under their feet, nurture their young, build a nest, roost, forage for food, or socialize as nature intended. In fact, most are actually bred to suffer because they've been genetically selected to grow too big, too fast. And just one example of this is hens in the egg industry. They lay approximately an egg a day, but in nature, when they descended from the red jungle fowl, they would lay 12 eggs a year, one a month. It's a vast difference. And there's all sorts of associated problems with that, just depletion of calcium and osteoporosis and a vast array of problems. You probably can't read all the bits around the infographic, but these are what you could describe as intrinsic cruelties, because they are problems in any type of system. This is with egg-laying hens, who are a completely different breed to the ones that are bred for meat. Not everybody knows that. Eggs are not a byproduct. They're of you know, the chicken meat industry, a separate breed. So I could go on quite a bit about these things and the realities, I suppose, but I don't want to run out of time, and perhaps we can always come back to that if people have questions like, oh, how are meat chickens different and that sort of thing. And again, with their deaths, I mean, there's a process where, you know, you have to get animals who are, they've never been taught to be trusting of humans for good reason. Even when there is an abject abuse going on, they are subjected to all sorts of painful procedures whenever a human is there. So obviously the catching process, whether they're chickens or cows, is stressful and traumatic for them, and there's force involved. Whether it's just grabbing chickens by one leg in large bunches of five and stuffing them into crates, which often causes breakages and dislocations, or it's cattle putting them into the trucks, etc. So this is a violent process, there's no getting around that. But yeah, I'm not going to subject you to a graphic video. Instead, what I wanted to do is just mention quickly Brisbane Animal Save, which is one of our newest initiatives of ALQ. So Animal Save is a movement that's global, it started in Canada. And the idea came from Tolstoy, actually, the idea of bearing witness to those who are suffering. So I might just read a quotation from Tolstoy, which sort of informed and inspired this movement. He said, "When the suffering of another creature causes you to feel pain, do not submit to the initial desire to flee from the suffering one, but on the contrary, come closer, as close as you can to him who suffers, and try to help." Now, we're under no illusions that we're actually going to be able to help the animal. Oh, sorry, I should explain what we do first. We do peaceful vigils outside slaughterhouses. So we stop the trucks for a couple of minutes, even sometimes shorter, depending, you know. It's entirely peaceful. It's not a protest against anybody. It's a vigil that's paying respect and acknowledging and standing in solidarity with those victims and just recognizing where they've come from, how they've traveled, and where they're about to be going. So that's the primary thing, and the reason, the power of the vigil is that it's public, and it's standing up against what we see as a great injustice. And I think the fact that we've come to this stage with the movement is pretty big. I think historically we look back and say, that was a moment where people were no longer willing to go along with the turning a blind eye to what's going on. And obviously, most of the time, the people that come are already pretty convinced of the reasons to change, you know, personal choice and to be part of the change. But they're very peaceful, welcoming, and gentle places, like events, and everybody is welcome. So, and there's nothing really quite like looking straight in the eyes of these beings, because that's when you realise they're somebody, not something. And even for me, who I've been vegan like, I don't know, 16 years and vegetarian since the age of 9 and whatever, so I've already been through it all, it's still a very powerful experience for me. So I guess, I don't know if it can move you until you've done it, but we have a very short video just from the last vigil we did, and I just wanted to see if I can make that play, which would be interesting. Might just try to speed up a little bit. there's, I did a slide about, you know, humane options, because I guess most people think, oh, you know, there's better ways to consume meat. But when you think about the population of humans on the world, on the planet, really we can't sustain meat eating, especially kind of three times a day like we have at the moment, without intensive systems. And at the moment, less intensive systems make up only about 2% of, and that's in Australia as well as around the world. And also, you know, routine practices remain. If you're using a fellow being for profit, there's kind of very little way to be humane about it. We still exploit the reproductive systems of farmed animals. We destroy motherhood and families. There are routine mutilations without anaesthetic, and we deny them important instinctive behaviours and preferences. So that's just a quick one on that, and we can always, hopefully, have time, like, chat more about that if it comes up. I did also want to mention that it's not only the non-human animals, it's humans as well who suffer in the meat, dairy and eggs industry. There's well-documented links between domestic violence and working in slaughterhouses, and there's also, I guess a lot of you are psychologists, so I'll probably use the wrong terminology, but I've heard about a version of post-traumatic stress disorder, which is specifically suffered by perpetrators. So these are people who are not necessarily trying to be violent, but their job is inherently violent, and they suffer greatly as a result. And there's just study after study shows this link. Just the other day, I saw a write-up of one that's drawn a link between bullying, cyberbullying, and abusive behavior towards animals. So it's like a widespread study, and finding that people who'd engaged in hurting or killing animals were more involved in bullying as well as other humans. Then there's, of course, well, I don't know how much this is known, but basically when it comes to production of meat, we could actually eliminate the worst cases of world hunger with about 40 million tons of food, but 20 times that amount is fed to animals on factory farms every year. So, and there have been a lot of studies about that too. We don't have to be suffering from such massive food inequity in the world. And then there's the climate change link. So I don't know, again, how well known it is, but the livestock sector is responsible for more climate change emissions than the whole of the transport sector. And we could go into that in more detail as well. It's just, unfortunately, there tends to be a bit of a deafening silence around this in climate change discussions, even from great organisations like 350.org. So anyway, that's another whole discussion, but there is, you know, there are human costs here, and costs to wildlife as well. If you imagine that one third of the land surface of the earth is given over to animal farming, just imagine how much more space there could be for nature if we were to eat directly, just eat the plants instead. So then this is not to mention the diseases of excess that we suffer. And in the rich world, the impending catastrophe of antibiotic resistance and all sorts of other related issues. So, I'll just skip through these. So I wanted to do a whole kind of section on the kind of misalignment of our values with our appetites. I've touched on it already, but you know, we all have these shared values that include compassion and justice, and we oppose harming animals, but we still eat them. So, you know, what's going on. And I can tell the story of this graphic if there's time later, but I think I'm going to have to skip it now. And there's just a couple of concepts here that I wanted to mention. So speciesism, not a word everybody will know, not a very nice sounding word, but it's like other forms of prejudice based purely on membership of a particular group. So it's giving lower moral status and concern to others based purely on what species they are a member of. And this is borne out quite well when you think about why we love dogs, but we eat pigs and wear cows, which is the name of a book by Melanie Joy, who's on the left there. She's a psychologist who's done a lot of work, and she coined the term carnism, which is specifically looking at the consumption of animals. And she described carnism as kind of the opposite of veganism. And she says it's an invisible belief system that conditions us to eat certain animals, and that can change depending on your culture. You know, here it's chickens, pigs, turkeys, cows, etc., sheep. In China, you might include dogs and cats in that. You know, it's about how we've been conditioned, and it's a dominant ideology, so it tends to go unspoken or unnoticed. And the only ones who are thought to be bringing a set of ideas to the table are the vegans or vegetarians. But actually, her argument is that, you know, carnism is still a belief system as well. And then she talks in detail about what she calls, I guess, the justifications. And these are, there's three main ends: the normal, natural, and necessary. And I guess with the normal, I wanted to cover that. So, you know, it's just how we grow up. We're told that you eat meat, but the same goes for oppressions of all kinds. It doesn't, that in itself doesn't make it okay. And the same with natural, this idea that that it's natural for humans to eat meat. I mean, there's two things there. One is, you know, natural does not give us a guide to our ethics. And also, I would question how natural, considering the process we have to go through to actually get to making the meat palatable for ourselves. Anyway, I'm running out of time, and I would have liked to go a bit more into that, but I don't want to miss the chance for questions, so let me just see where we've got to. Ultimately, I think I just wanted to sort of question, highlight that for us the key is sentience, the ability to suffer, and not species membership. And that we can choose kindness, and this is actually, to some extent, I would argue, is coming home to who we really are. And this is where the second video comes in, so I might just do that as to end on, if that's cool. Yeah, hopefully.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
But I asked 250 students, how many of you are vegan? One child raised his hand. Then I asked them, so how many of you would deliberately hurt an innocent animal unnecessarily? Nobody raised their hands. Then I told them, by definition, all of you are vegan because you have compassion in your heart. That's who you are. Except who you are and what you do are not in alignment. When what we say and what we do are not in alignment, we suffer. Not only do we suffer, we cause suffering to others. I frame veganism as a journey home to who we really are. Becoming compassionate to all life. We are all in different places in this journey. And because we are all unique, your place is your place. So you have to find your way home. The best we can do is to help each other as we come home to who we really are.
Sorry about all the technological glitches there. Now, we might
might, because we started just a minute or two late, we might just still give a couple of minutes for a couple of questions. If you do need to go to the next room because you're interested in any of those presentations, please feel free to do so. Yeah.
Do you have a question for Dr. Kipps?
Sort of a question, really.
Yes, sure.
I felt for you in you presenting this in the sense that there is a sort of prohibition on animal activists presenting graphic videos. And it just links in very much with what you presented, James, I think, in your talk about. That's a classic example of fears of compassion activating, that we don't even want to look at the difficult videos in case it activates something in us that is, you know, too deep and too difficult to even look at what animals suffer.
It's such a good point, and I mean, again, not speaking as a psychologist, but I've heard that if you show people traumatic things, as I think as I mentioned, they can sometimes turn it back and blame you, and then they close the actual message. So we have to tread that line really carefully.
Just being aware we're still just having a conversation. So as you come in, please just try to be as quiet as possible.
So I just wanted to say we do have stalls where we actually pay people to watch the videos, you know, because we just can't get people to engage, because I think they know what they're going to see. And they don't want to engage with that. You know, so it's a really difficult thing for our movement. It's something we spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to get people to engage with something that they're consciously trying to keep them out of the distance. Yeah.
Any other questions?
You know, things like organic meat, is that, it's still not considered, because like you said, the rooting practices are still in play, but is that still a better choice for some people?
I mean, I definitely thought that myself for a while, and I allowed that to kind of stop me looking into it, I guess. But I was just the other day reading about the sort of marketing potential of organic, and they kept saying that lower cruelty, in fact they use the term cruelty free, and that this is a huge perceptual advantage, and yet there's nothing actually in there to do with cruelty as such in those things. You can still do the de-beaking, the hot iron branding, castration without anesthetic. And sometimes it can potentially be worse because they don't give them antibiotics, so they end up suffering. I mean, obviously the antibiotic overuse is a major problem, but that's done purely to sort of keep the meat cleaner for people, but actually, or the milk or whatever, but it does mean that animals are often suffering more because they're not treated when they have illness and lameness and things. But it certainly is a better choice, and I would always encourage people to start wherever they feel comfortable and then just get ready to maybe open the next chapter when you feel ready and just read a bit more or look online at some really great programs like veganeasy.org. Which is run by Animal Liberation Victoria, that sort of was designed in concert with the other animal lives around the country.
We'll just have to stop it there. No, this is very interesting to talk about. Thank you so much.